This is the stat you need to know. Students are now being required to pay more tuition, greater percent of tuition than ever before. Well, the people who are going to get hot in the collar about that are parents who are chucking out those bucks. And so what I would do is I would start that as my issue, and that will change the bill.
Can I say something?
Yes.
In 2009, I drove to McDonough, Georgia, and met with Jim Walls of Atlanta and Filter and said, look here and look here and look here. He wrote a tremendously wonderful article about all the money on the table. It was $7 million on the table to seven presidents. I have done exactly what you're saying, and I've gotten nowhere.
If the point I'm asking you, what I'm saying.
As I said, the tuition's going up, their pockets are filling up.
Okay, but the point is, all right, if I'm, how many students are in the university system at Georgia? Okay, and they're getting paid by this. So when you point out to the parents that that ratio of state appropriation to tuition is going up, you get them hot about that issue, it will change the behavior of the board of regents.
I guess what I'm saying is I will certainly try again, but I have done that, and in fact, in the flyer I'll give you, there's two pages of fiscal misappropriations of millions of dollars that I have kept up with and have put out there as much as I can.
The point is, the parents don't care about that.
Right.
What you said. One of them is the AJC report that says tuition has gone up again, and that the administrators are still getting millions of dollars on the table.
Well, what I would say is I see your point, and I agree with your point. And you could write the most Pulitzer Prize worthy article, just absolute perfection. But how do the people in the state of Georgia actually read it? I get around 10,000 visitors to my site a week, which is pretty good for a blog, and I just started in July, so I think it's actually fantastic. Hopefully I'll get 100,000 by next year. But only 6,000 people are reading my articles about the Board of Regents, and I've written a story about the tuition, by the way. I've already written that story. How do I get people to read that? That's the next step. That's the missing step.
This is what you're going to have to do with teaming up with people doing social media so that it bubbles up to the public consciousness. And how you do that is, don't take this as glib, put a cat video on. No. But how you do that is you've got to get somebody set on fire. So if you're going to do the research on what makes, for example, social media go viral, the same way when Robin Cook wrote Come all those years ago, he did an analysis of what made bestsellers for novels. That's exactly what it is. He took every single piece and put it together in a single book, and that's why Coleman was a bestseller. Figure out, there's a lot of research now out on what makes things tend to go viral. And if you've got something that seems really mundane, because finance, people don't like to hear about finances, but if you're pointing out to them, okay, if you've got a college-age kid, you're going to have a college-age kid, okay, this is what you can expect to be paying out of your pocket. This is what this Board of Regents is making. This is what these presidents are making. And you personalize it and you make it something. It gets picked up here, it gets picked up here, it gets picked up here. And then all these little pockets that we've been talking about, you give them a reason to coalesce. It's going to get somebody's attention. And it may be the AJC's attention.
I'm working with Jeff Seltzer of the Atlanta Journal on some stories on the Board of Regents and exactly what you're saying. For example, Huckabee, the chancellor, he makes over $500,000 a year. Okay. A lot of people don't know that.
Our county school superintendent makes more than Huckabee.
Is the place to build yourself a fusion table for Board of Regents and all the school officials across the United States comparatively with cost of living factors and put a fusion table up there, and I guarantee you that kind of stuff gets here.
Right. Guys, a lot of this goes beyond open government transparency, but let me just ask you a quick question again. How many of you are with watchdog groups? And how many of you have websites and blogs? And how many of those websites and blogs are linked to one another? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
What I'm saying is you're not, you think you're doing the networking, but you're really not. Kristen Finney's in the back of the room, and she's a digital editor. And I'm sure Kristen will probably tell you that it's not just enough to throw something on a site or throw something on a blog. You've got to build all of those connections. How many of you have groundbreaking video on your sites?
Roy does.
Well, and the thing about it is, and a guy like me hates to admit this, but if you want attention, you got to have video. How many times do you ever hear people say viral words? You ever heard that? Never. Right? The only kind of viral word that I know of is Ebola. So the only way that you get viral is by doing what? By video. The only thing you ever heard is going viral is viral videos. But we're not, you're not doing those kinds of things. So again, a lot of this goes sort of outside of the parameters of open government. But I guess part of the message that I'm trying to tell you is you think that you have raised awareness and that you're, again, beating the drum, but you're only beating a small drum in a small area.
Absolutely.
It's going to take the networking, the collectivity, the collaboration, the amalgamation of everything that you're talking about. Okay, we had some other, yeah, back here.
My name's Ron Davis. I'm from Paulding County.
All right.
And regarding the open.georgia.gov website, do you know if there are any counties who have embraced the effort to create something similar like to that site, but on a county level?
Let me tell you something unbelievable. Everybody knows who Victor Hill is, right?
Yeah.
Everybody knows about how corrupt Clayton County is, right? Clayton County, Georgia, has one of the most transparent websites in the state of Georgia. They, sunshine.org and that group has given Clayton County kudos for the transparency of its website. There are some people that are doing things to make government more transparent. However, they also have 3-hour standing executive sessions almost every month. So I'm not here to tell you that Clayton County is getting it all right. But there are some good models going on out there. And again, please don't think, I'm not in any way in the hip pocket of government telling you that government's getting it right. But when government does make agendas and meeting minutes available on their website, dadgummit, give them credit for it. Pat them on the back for doing that. That's what you want them to do. We're not trying to prove how bad they are. We want them to be better, don't we? So when they do get it right, put it on your blog. If you're a county commissioner or the people you're blogging about all of a sudden decides that they're going to talk about personnel or land acquisition in an open public meeting, give them kudos for doing that. Let's hold them accountable. Let's hold their feet to the fire. Let's call them scum when they are. But when they're not, when they get it right, let's give them a thumbs up.
When it happens, let us know.
Like I said, Clayton County developed one of the most transparent government websites in Georgia. And when I was up there, we gave them credit for it. And the next time, we slapped them in the face for saying that they were required to go in executive session.
I want to get back to the long distance issues. I'm Metro editor at the Times in Gainesville.
Hi. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah, I'm good. A lot of our issues are with law enforcement. Certainly have ours with the commission and the city council. But going back to incident reports, I'm pretty sure I know the answer, but we have an issue with our Gainesville Police Department. Yes, we want the incident report. Well, it's not done yet. We want the big complaints. But you can't have, they're, you know, they cannot be notified 2 days later, 3 days later. 4 days later, oh, we have some names.
We had an incident where we were 2 feet in front of a suspect that was being arrested, and
we had a picture on the top page. This big.
I could read to you the tattoos on his chest.
Okay, let me ask you this, and I'm not picking on the newspaper. I do what you do. Has the newspaper done a front page story saying Gainesville PD denies incident report?
Breaking the law.
Fails to release names.
It was in the article about the incident.
Put it in a headline.
Yeah.
Honestly, if you can't get them to do the right thing because it's the law, embarrass the heck out of them.
Yeah, but I mean, is it the law? I mean, when do they have to finish that incident report?
Holly can address this, but what the law says, what I would suggest to you, is that the incident report is a record, and the record has to be made available when they have it.
I mean, the one rule of thumb of law enforcement is that initial incident reports are immediately available regardless of the status of the investigation. The question you raise, I don't think there is any time a police department has to, I mean, I don't know, it's certainly not an open records issue. I mean, it's a great way to get around the Open Records Act, though, isn't it? If you just delay creating the record. So.
And I guess that's the question. Is the record there or not?
That's the story.
Yeah. But is the record there? I mean, it could be that
they have created. I don't know.
It could be that it is created, but they're telling you that it's not created.
What I run into is they won't give it to you until it's approved by the chief or the sheriff, and it's not.
Now, and I'm assuming you guys have had, is this the SO, the PD, both?
This is the city.
Right, and I'm assuming you've had that conversation with the chief.
Yep.
Chief recently got fired.
Oh, he got fired. I've heard good stories about that, yeah.
Whole other thing here. We've got a new interim chief right now, and we're hoping to make some headway with a new publisher as well.
Well, and the other thing is reach out to me, to Holly. Ask us to comment for an article or to pick up the telephone or send a letter and say, hey, we understand that the Times is having some difficulty here. What's up with that? Now, let me talk very quickly. And I know nobody's brought this up yet, but it's interesting to me. Anybody had trouble with the new mugshot bill? Basically, the mugshot bill says that you have to sign a piece of paper or send a letter that tells local law enforcement that you're not going to misuse their mugshot. Now, I will tell you that I think the mugshot is a public record and that it is a dangerous, slippery slope to put any kind of restrictions on what can or cannot be done with the public record, or that you should have to tell government why you want anything.
What's misuse mean exactly?
Well,
it was targeted,
or that you're not going to sell it.
It was targeted towards the mugshot sites where they charge people to take photos.
And I'm going to tell you all this, is that I was a part of the lobby to lobby for the mugshot bill. And I don't like the bill. But let me tell you what the original bill said. The original bill that Representative Strackman passed to the committee said that mugshots were exempt from the open record. The affidavit, the statement, was a compromise. It's not a compromise that I'm personally comfortable with, because I think it's a slippery slope anytime we put additional further restrictions on the open record act. But we still at least do have access to mugshots. And so I guess a more targeted question I'm asking you is, has anybody been denied a mugshot since the mugshot bill was passed?
The way they did it in Gwinnett is, and I don't know how it is for the average Joe, but the way they did it in Gwinnett is me and him and whoever might write a crime story signed one piece of paper, we got a password for the site, and I think we have to re-sign the paper every year.
Right, and that's going to be my recommendation to you guys, is that you have a relationship with SO, with PD, with whoever maintains those mugshots, to have a letter or statement on file. If you have an adversarial relationship, they could theoretically tell you that every single time you want a mugshot that you've got to go under file request. And I'd hate to see that happen. And I hate those mugshot.com. They're extortions. You know, what they tell you is you get arrested for something, maybe it's a DUI or whatever, but, you know, let's say it gets thrown out, or, maybe there is a conviction, but it's there on their site in perpetuity. I mean, it's there forever, unless you call them and say, take my mugshot down, and their answer is, sure, we'll take your mugshot off of there. We don't want everybody looking at your face every time you apply for a job. Just need $400.
And of course, they have sister sites, affiliate mugshot.org or whatever.
Right, and once it's up. So I'm not comfortable with the bill that was passed, but I will tell you it is preferable to the bill that was proposed. Have you had experience with the mugshot bill?
Why can't the law say you can't extort people with their mugshot?
Well, that was the law that they actually passed in 2012 or 13.
Oh, really?
And they found out that they were having difficulty enforcing it, basically because, and I know this is going to sound simplistic and funny, they couldn't find mugshots.com anywhere.
Yeah.
This deals with an open records issue I've got.